out to the altar if you're not carrying something. Notice when our altar service will come in, the crucifixion, the two candles are not going to bow to the altar. But our one altar server who doesn't carry anything, he's going to bow, isn't he? So let's go ahead and start that up. Let's pretend like we're out there, we've lined up about 3 minutes before Mass when the warning, 3 minute warning bells go off, chimes go off, you go and you set up, and pretty soon everything is ready to go, it's Mass time, I'll give the signal, and they'll start playing the opening hymn, right? And then after the first verse of the opening hymn, everybody starts walking in. So go ahead. And then the priest will come up. There's a deacon with him. Deacon two will come up and bow and reverence the altar. And then go to the chair. And the Mass will be started, okay? We always begin with the sign of the cross and have a greeting, right? That kind of a thing. We do the penitential rite. Blah, 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 blah. And what will happen is if there's a Gloria at the Mass, like on Sunday, we'll sing the Gloria and all that. And pretty soon the priest will say, "Let us pray." That's a signal to bring the Roman Missal over.
Whenever his book is moving, it kind of messes with his equilibrium.
It's like you're aboard ship.
So he really would like for this book to rest on your collarbone so that, for one, this book is heavy, and for two, it's not wiggling for him.
Yeah, it's hard to read when it moves around or it gets dropped down and goes like this all the time. And it's real easy. If you just lean it against your collarbone, all the weight is off. And it can be very, very steady. So we all set the prayer, we're going to sit down, okay? First reading, responsorial song, if there's a second reading, whatever. There'll be a certain point when it's time for the gospel. So it's time for the gospel. What are you guys going to do with the candles? You're going to get up and get your candle. Say a little prayer, prepare themselves to proclaim the gospel, and then step back, and then they're going to go over. Now, we've decided a while ago that you would go over side by side, would you? Okay, so go ahead and over. There you go. Deacon Chip wanted that, so we agreed to that, okay? The Lord be with you, and so forth, the gospel. The gospel of the Lord, praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Okay. And what are you guys going to do? And they're going to put their candle away. If there's a deacon, he's going to have the gospel book, right? He's going to put the gospel book back, and that'll be a sign for everybody. It's just a lectionary note at the end of the gospel. Just sit down, right? And depending on who's preaching, you're going to get a homily, right? Maybe from the ambo, or maybe from down here, like I do, whatever. You do the school kids, like this morning and stuff like that, with the hand mic and all that kinds of stuff. So you're going to get the homily. And the priest and the deacon will come back.
Ask a quick question. Sure. If it's a deacon,
gospel book only has the gospels in it. It doesn't have the first and second readings and responsorial psalm stuff. When all those are together, it's called a lectionary, a reading book. Okay? You never enthrone a reading book. So if it's a priest by himself, he'll finish the gospel at the imbo, and that's your signal to go. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, everybody sits down. If not, the gospel book will be enthroned. We're trying to get the organist to quit playing and have the gospel book go down and the actual music stop at the same time. We haven't gotten to that yet, but we're working on it. Okay? And that's the signal to go ahead and sit down, and then you're going to get your calm. No, once he puts the book down, you guys can come over together if he's not preaching.
Okay.
But he may be preaching. One out of every four Sundays, the deacons preach, do you notice? Okay. Anything else? Ask questions as we go along. That's how you're going to learn. Okay? Visual and questions. Okay? So the priest will come back, the deacon will come back, will sit down. If it's a Sunday, the solemnity will do the creed, won't we? If it's a weekday mass, like for a kids' mass, probably there won't be a creed. Probably just a memorial of some sort. Okay? So let's pretend it's the creed. So we stood up for the creed. We've done the creed. Then we're going to do the creed. Let's pretend it's a Sunday. So I believe in one God. We do the creed. And at the end of the creed, we're going to do the prayer of the faithful, right? Okay? So let us confidently approach the throne of grace and prayer for our church and our world. And if there's no deacon, the lector will get up and do the petitions. If there is a deacon, he'll be standing here, and what you'll have to do is turn this way so he can see the petitions, okay? And then when he gets done the petition, he's got to come back my way to end the prayer. Now, we've been doing the Respect for Life prayer in October, haven't we? But that will come to an end October 31st. So we'll be back to a normal conclusion to the prayer, right? So we'll conclude the prayer. Let's just say, amen. I'll take this back. Thank you. I'll sit down. Now what are the altar servers going to do at this point? Veteran? Let the altar take. And they're not going to knock over a cup.
Jesus.
Now we're doing this like as if this is a Sunday Mass. There are two corporals on the front part of the altar to tell you where to put the cup. You have the purificators, the little cross with them, like that, and they're going to take the stand that they brought them over with. Okay.
All right. Father Russ likes his book in the center of the altar without a book stand. Father Dexter likes his book in the center of the altar without a book stand. But Father Mike wants the book stand. He can't see the book when it's laying flat. He needs a little help. So he will always use the book stand.
That's the only real difference, I think, between the three of us.
It is. It's the only difference.
The only difference. Okay? Now let's pretend it's a Sunday. So what's going to happen? The usher's going to come up. How should we pretend to be the usher? Okay? So you come up here and you're going to collect and let the children come to me and all that kind of stuff, right? And then they're going to start passing out the baskets to everybody, okay? And when they start going down, go down the center aisle for us, Alex. Like you're going to the back. You're going to go down a certain part down the center of the altar, and that's going to be a signal for the cross bearer. And when they go and get their, because now you're going to go get the people bringing up the gifts, right?
Right, Jim. How many do you say that? Just the cross? Just about three? All things? Even just three?
That's a good point. If there's just three altar servers at the mass, then the candles won't go back. It's the crucifix. You need somebody to help me to collect the plates going up, right? So now it's time. All the people are there with the patties and the wine, etc. Now they're going to come forward.
Okay, let me remind the altar servers that are coming over here with Father. As you notice, John walked behind Father. Do not ever walk in front of Father to come over here to stand. Always go behind.
He knows judo. You don't want to
always go behind Father. Do not walk in front of him.
In
Ted?
I'll usually come up enough that you can come behind me.
Okay. And then the people will give me stuff, okay? Thank you for representing the community this morning.
Thank you for representing the community this morning.
Give you a little blessing. Thank you.
Father?
There you go.
Now what's going to happen, Officer Service? Pour wine in there. Pour wine all the way around into the cups. I'll have an empty decanter. Get that back. Say the prayer. Plate and that. Say a little prayer to myself. And we'll wash the hand. Okay? Don't need a lot of water, just a little bit of water. Thank you. This is the regular Sunday Mass. We're not going to do anything.
Right. And don't forget, whenever you're washing Father's hands, go up on the to the altar. Not at the floor here. Go up onto the altar.
Then I invite people to pray. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. You give a response
the Lord
back.
Accept the sacrifice.
Signal for everybody in the congregation to stand upright. Stand up too. Then we're going to do the second collect, second prayer, the prayer for the gifts. Okay. Finish that and then amen. Come back. The Lord be with you. With your spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just. Okay.
Then I'm going to do the preface, the Eucharistic prayer, which ends with something like, as with one voice we acclaim, holy, holy, holy. Either say it or sing it, right? And that's a signal. You don't have to do now, just sit down now, but you know you would kneel, right? Then the priest is going to do the Eucharistic prayer, and at one point we'll ask the Holy Spirit to come down upon the gifts, called the epiclesis. Okay? And then he'll take the big host, say the word, okay? And he's going to put it out. And what's going to happen? Now, what we want to do is we want to have some practice on that. Don't be afraid of the bells. Are you any good?
That's it. That's what I want.
Three rings. Okay? Ding-a-ling-a-ling, ding-a-ling-a-ling, ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling. Okay?
And we want somebody to do this at all of the masses.
All masses. Okay? Then the same thing to say the words over the cup.
Was that too fast?
That's okay. And then, you know, in the mystery of faith, we're going to do the mystery of faith, okay? And the Eucharistic prayer continues, okay? And, you know, through him, with him, and in him, okay? Which ends with the great amen, right? The doxology, amen. That's a signal for everybody to stand upright. And then, as the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say the Our Father, or we'll sing the Our Father, one or the other. Priest does this thing that's called the embolism. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, okay? Which ends with, for the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Interesting.
Amen. Okay? Priest says another prayer about peace. Then he says, the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And then either the priest or deacon will say, let us offer each other the sign of peace. Okay? If I have a deacon here, after we give our sign of peace, he'll go back and get the ciborium, okay? And usually I'll come over here to wish peace to all the altar servers, because I'm freed up, I don't have to go back to get the ciborium, okay? Now, by myself, I'll go back and get the ciborium, so I won't be over there to give you the sign of peace, because I got to go get the ciborium, okay? So I get the ciborium back. We've got all these patents all over the altar and everything else like that, okay? And then I'll hold the host up, Lamb of God, right? It takes away the sins of the world, all that kind of stuff, okay? Jesus Christ, and I said, and now we're going to get to the point where everybody's kneeling, and I'm going to pick up a part of the host and say, behold the Lamb of God. You can sit down for now, but pretend like you're kneeling. He takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you down under my roof. Blah, 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 blah. Okay? I'm going to receive communion. Okay? The extraordinary ministers are going to come up. Give them communion and give out all the cups and everything else, right? We're going to go and distribute communion. Okay? So now we're done distributing communion. Everybody's coming back to the altar. The people with the cups are taking their cups away, right? I'm taking and putting everything back into the ciborium, giving the packet back. I or the deacon take the ciborium back and put it in the tabernacle, and we come on out. Okay? So communion, in that sense, is done. So what's going to happen next? Water.
They'll drop it.
We're going to put some, I'm going to purify my chalice. I'm going to give back the, let's give that Roman Missal. The drink. Clean her up. By this time, and this goes, those are ready, pretend like those are ready or gone, because they've taken them back, okay? And I'll go back to the chair. Moment of silence, sacred silence, huh? Then I'm going to say, let us pray. Open up the book, say the third column, ends with amen. Weekday Mass, we give the dismissal. Sunday Mass, please have a seat for the announcements. Okay. And then the dismissal. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Then either I say or the deacon says, go in peace. You say, thanks be to God. Now what did all the service do? Is it that? You okay with it? Is it difficult? Understand?
Bring the cross back up here for a minute. Okay. In the candles. When you carry the cross, see how his hands are apart? Make sure that your hands are spread far enough apart. Because if his hands are really close, it's real hard and this wobbles like this. So make sure that your hands are always far enough apart. And you don't have to carry it all the way to the bottom. He's carrying it at a good height. Alright? Candle. When you're carrying the candle, notice that he's lifting this candle up far enough that he's not going to kick it. And if you feel like you're going to kick it, it doesn't hurt to have it just a little bit higher. But if you kick it, it makes the candle go like that. He ends up with the hot wax on his head.
I've seen some of you doing like this. You know, like, because you don't want to kick this one, so you're walking like this, you know, several times, especially girls. So you don't want, like, I've seen that.
So if you raise it high enough, you won't have to try to straddle the candle to walk with it.
If it doesn't.
Yeah, it takes longer.
If it doesn't feel right, it's probably not right, so readjust.
Right. Take a little bit smaller step if you have to.
If you have to really work hard at doing it, you probably need some advice to do it a different way.
And ask the MC that is at that mass, you know, ask one of the adults that you know is a server. That's the best way. We don't mind you asking. We'd rather have for you to ask them to trip over it or fall or, you know, it makes it easier.
Did actually would add that?
I just want to clarify the dress code for men. How about for boys? For men? What is the dress code?
Well, I don't know that we have a set written out, do we?
No, we haven't, but you know, they should, like you mentioned earlier, dress appropriately. You know,
no writing on your shirt. Try not to have writing.
No t-shirts.
Right.
They just a dress type t-shirt.
How about the pants?
As long as they've got, you know, if they have a...
No blue jeans?
A lot of them wear jeans. Okay. You know, some of them are nice looking dress kind of jeans. As long as they're, but because their out covers them.
How about their shoes?
Shoes need to be, you know, nice, stable, tie shoes usually. No flip-flops, nothing that would hang off.
How about tennis shoes?
They wear tennis shoes a lot. You know, a lot of the kids don't. You know, the kids grow out of these shoes so fast, a lot of parents don't want to buy dress shoes and tennis shoes, and they've got school shoes too.
I think as long as they look, a lot of times those shoes are more expensive than a dress shoe. And the same thing with the dungarees. A lot of the dungarees are very expensive.
I don't want to see your muddy shoes that you've been out on the four-wheeler in for altar service.
So as long as they're knee tightly, not right. You know, loose tight or anything, and as long as you're neatly dressed, then you know I think it's
sure.
It's
fine. How about other pairs like this? Because I've seen several of you wear flip-flops.
Yeah, flip-flops are really not acceptable.
The thing is. It's not about you, it's not about us priests, it's about the mass. If your parents could tell you, you have to wear shoes because you're serving. Mom, I want to wear flip-flops. Don't serve. If you show up in my mass, you're wearing flip-flops, don't. I just want to clear it. Because, you know, the people who are, this is an altar. Even the Eucharistic ministers, they don't go up here because this is a holy place. And the only people who goes there, they'll go there, priest and you, altar service. And you're just wearing flip-flops for the Lord. Don't do that. I mean, I just want to clear up that, you know, that, that's why I asked about the dress code. So please don't wear flip-flops, you know, boys or girls.
Some of the noise that they make, too.
Yeah.
They, you know, when you're walking and it's quiet and you're carrying a candle and you get up before the music starts, I mean, it's also that noise that is disrupting as well.
And remember, when you're sitting over here, everybody sees you. So if you've got your out and you're flipping it, or you're sitting here doing your arms, you know, everybody sees what you're doing. So try to remember to sit still. Pay attention to the priest. If you're watching the Mass and paying attention to the priest, he may decide he wants a glass of water. You know, you want to be there to be able to go get that for him. He may need something else, you know. So if you're always paying attention to the priest during the Mass, you're not thinking about all this fidgeting and everything. Listen to what the readings are about. Yeah. So you'll know what happened for, you know, that day.
Since you're going to take over the altar service, we've been doing our hands like this because that's how Father Clark taught us when he was doing it. Do this when you're standing, you're sitting, hands are on your knees. What do you want? What do you prefer?
You just, if we want to make a uniform, like, this would be good. Or like this. But we need at least, you know, at least like the two, like Jim and Jim is doing this and he's doing like this. So it's not good to see. It should be, we have to decide, are we gonna do like this or are we gonna
do
like this?
What's most comfortable for y'all? Y'all make the decision. Like this?
Personally, I think this is more respectful.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of
but we still have to think that we've got kids. You know, the kids are not little priests. They, you know, they forget this, you know, how they should be. They're comfortable, they do this. And so
So this is, seems to be what they want. So let's.
And don't put your hands in here. Just put it in your belly. If you want to do this, if you decide to do this, then do like this. And if you want to do like this, I think that's fine too.
That's, so that's what you want? This? Not this? They're all holding their hands this way.
Okay. That's fine.
Is that okay?
It's our candidate.
All right.
Okay. Ringing bell seems to be of trouble for some people. Would you like to come up before you leave and take a chance at ringing the bells? You feel comfortable ringing bells?
Is anybody here who wants to become an incense bearer? You know, like, if you want to be to do some incense, you could probably stay for. Are we gonna do it today? Or?
What? I'm not doing incense.
Okay, not today. But
not today.
Okay.
That's gonna be another day.
Okay.
Sometimes you'll notice during the mass, the sacristan has put out too many Eucharist, and Father needs another ciborium. Could you go get one, please? Do you know where to go get a ciborium or a purificator? If we had a big spill and they needed another purificator, would you know where to go get that? All right, we're going to go to the back, and we won't do it right this second, but we're going to go back. I'm going to show you where that stuff is kept, because you need to know if Father asked for a purificator or a ciborium. This is a ciborium. What he would put the Eucharist in to take it back to the tabernacle. And sometimes you'll see the MCs go and get one, but if you don't have an MC there, he's going to be looking at one of you guys to go and pick that up for him.
What about the batteries? Do you have extra batteries back there somewhere too?
There are some batteries back there
in the drawers.
In the drawers.
Okay. Well, sometimes
the lights go out. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, let's go back here for a minute, and then we're going to look at this. And I also want you to go to the altar before you leave and look how these cups are sitting and what they're sitting on. You'll notice that there's another cloth there for them to sit on. Ask for a drink of water there on that side.
Hi.
All right, let me tell you what happened this past weekend. At one of the masses.
Were you late?
At the mass last weekend, one of the servers, you remember the tall cups that we had?
Mm-hmm.
That set, one of them fell off of the tray. When it fell to the floor, it broke. He didn't do it on purpose. It just happened. It was just an accident. So we've changed the cups that we're using over here. They're shorter. But if you drop a cup, somebody's going to get up and help you. Don't worry about it. If it breaks, it breaks. There's nothing you can do about it. It's not like you purposely took that cup and threw it on the floor. He feels really bad that he broke the cup. But it's okay. If you drop something, it's okay. You did not mean to do it. We're going to pick up and carry on just as if nothing happened. All right? Did you show them where the purificators were?
No.
All right. It's marked purificators. A purificator is the little cloth with the red cross on it. Sometimes somebody may have a spill of the precious blood and need another purificator because they've taken theirs and put over the floor. So immediately get up and come back here and get a purificator for those people, because that minister will need a clean purificator. All right? Any other question about what happens back here? Did you show where the cups were?
Yes.
For a drink?
Yes.
All right. Father Russ has his own cup. And he usually has it prepared and he fixes his own water. He has a green cup for ordinary time. And he has a clear cup when it's supposed to be white. So he's color coordinated with, even with his drinking cups.
All right, any more questions about back here? Y'all don't ask very many questions.
I got a comment.
Okay, what's your comment?
Lighting candles.
Lighting candles. Do you want to demonstrate how to light a candle with the candle stepper?
All right. Now, this is what you use to light and unlight your candle. Now, when you light your candle, if you don't know how to use matches, then ask an adult to light it for you, because I've had one person literally light themselves on fire. I'm not kidding about that. So, be careful with that.
If you don't know, don't ask.
Now,
ask for help.
When you want to extinguish it, you don't blow it out. There's this little device right here where you pull it down to extinguish it. Now, when you extinguish it, don't keep it down here because it gets locked in and the wax builds up right here. It dries up and
it won't come out.
So if this happens for some reason, just run this part over really hot water and it'll melt it, and then it'll allow you to get this out again. And then this eventually will run out. So to learn how to put this in, there are some extra lighting sticks in.
They're in these boxes. At the end of it, it's just going to go in part of the way, and it's going to fold up and just go down into the stick. Don't do a whole half one. The half of them. I have found some of the lighters that where people are putting it all the way up to the middle and putting two of the wicks at the top. It stops it up really quick. So you're just going to do about that much into the end of it. You want to bring me the... See, you'll look at the end of this one. See how it's just got a little bit to put in.
It fell out.
Of course. So you're just going to thread it through. Part of the way, let it bend up, and then pull it back down in there. All right?
Now, if you notice that one and the one in the lace actually are really short, if you put an entire one of these in, it's going to stick out about that far, and you won't be able to snuff it. So put it in there, pull the little lever all the way down, get some scissors, and snip it off at the top.
Yeah, because you'll have about that much left out, and that's too much to burn.
So are you recommending to just cut them in half before you start? Is it
sometimes in the back sacristy? I've already cut them in half for the kids. So okay. When they put them in the short ones, these back here, I try to take care of on Saturdays. But there's one back over there that's really long, and this one's short.
That one will take a whole one.
Will take a whole one. This okay. One does not.
Okay.
And remember that whenever you go out to put candles out, make sure you snuff the candles out. You have to leave it for a second. You can't just put it on and walk off. It's got to, you know, get rid of the oxygen first. Don't blow the candles. Don't pick at the wick that is there. And I say this because it happens. You know, I find kids picking at the wax. Don't pick at the wax. We had somebody to pick at the wax, and we caught him. He stuck it in his pocket real quick. He said it was saving it for him. He was making him a candle. Put the wax in the pockets, and if you just don't pick at them is really the best thing, because when you pick at that stuff, our candles over here have a lacquer finish on the top of them, and when you start picking and scraping at it, it scratches that up. All right.
I love it.
All right, let's go ring the bells. Yes.
A long time when I normally light the candles out on the altar.
Uh huh.
I'll light the snuffer. And then the wick will start burning away really quick.
Right. So you've just got to bring it out to light. Okay, well, so you can't light it like this. You got to turn this sideways to light your candle.
Right. I'll light it, and it'll start burning down, so I'll pull it out, and then it grows unusually big.
Yeah, but it's because you're putting too much out. So it goes out little at a time, just a very little at a time.
Okay.
All right? All right, let's go ring some bells.
There's just something in the handle. Whenever you ring it, like,
Grab that one candle again. I have time for you to explain the do's and don'ts I didn't before of how to carry and what not to do. To, right? Okay. If you'll grab that, I'll interview you in here.
All right, who's going to be the first person to ring the bell?
Me.
Who's closest to the bell? All right, let's ring the bell. Come on. I want to hear a good ring. Father, walk. Was that okay, Father?
That's good.
He liked that one. All right, another person, ring the bell. Three times. All right.
Does it have to turn?
Oh, sorry.
Can take it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just want to say that we need to treat these with respect. Remember that after they've been burning a while, there's hot liquid in the top. And if you kick them while you're walking, or if on the way back to the lay sacristy you turn them like this, you can spill hot wax on yourself, or on the floor, or on your owl. Or we don't want to blow them out when we get back here. We want to use the candle snuffer, snuff them out to keep from blowing wax all over. The wax is going to end up in the Bow Beach. It's just going to happen. It needs to be cleaned out, but it has to be done properly. You never scratch it with your fingernails or a key or knife or anything like that. It messes these up. Let the volunteers that clean up on Saturday take care of it. When you're walking, well, did they cover the walking with it?
Oh, go ahead with trying to where they should be from the floor, not to kick it again as a review. Yeah. And
you want to hold it up high enough so that you can't kick it, and you don't have to walk funny to keep from kicking the thing. You know, usually like a foot off the floor, so not all the way up to your knees, but a foot off the floor so it would keep you from kicking it. Try to hold it straight. Same way with the smaller candles over in the chapel. They don't have the long stick. They just got the little handle, and it's a little easier to get wobbly with them, but try to keep them straight up so that they don't spill wax on you or on the carpet or floor, wood floor over there.
Okay. Can you give us a run over of the alb closet and the do's and don'ts?
This is the alb closet, as you know. This is not where you hang them unless they have you have spilled some wine or wax or gotten them dirty some kind of way. Then you can put them on a hanger and hang them right here. Otherwise, if they're not dirty, they should be hung properly back on a hanger. Zip up the little zipper so that it stays nice and wrinkle-free, because if you throw them in here like this, they get wrinkled and have to be steamed before the next server wears
them. Is there a size? You're trying to go smallest to biggest in the closet as well?
There are. They start with the smallest sizes at this end and go all the way to the adult sizes at this end.
Are they numbered inside, or just look by length at the bottom?
It's written on the collars.
Okay.
You want to get one that gets down to like to the top of your shoe.
Okay.
You don't want it so far that it's touching the floor, because you may trip on it, and we don't want anybody to get hurt.
Okay.
We don't rod them up and throw them in the top of the closet. We don't rod them up and throw them under there. We don't lay them across a chair. They either go nicely hung on here, or hung on here if they're dirty and require laundry.
Okay.